Okay, this is active filter design. Lecture 3. In the last class, we saw one way of approximating the ideal brick wall low pass filter characteristic, and that was based on equating the value of the approximation as well as the slopes or derivatives of the approximation at the origin to the desired one, of course, to the best degree possible. So, we found that for a 2nth degree polynomial, obviously, if you don't want it to be identically equal to 0, the best you can do is to make all the 2n minus 1 derivatives equal to 0 at that point of approximation which was chosen to be the origin, and therefore, mod h of j omega whole square turned out to be 1 by 1 plus omega to the power 2n, where n is the order of the low pass filter. From this, we said we can find h of s into h of minus s by simply replacing omega in mod h of j omega whole square with s by j, and then you now have a polynomial of degree 2n whose roots correspond to the roots of d of s and d of minus s. The filter we want has poles in the left half s plane. So, if we identify all the roots of that polynomial which are in the LHP to d of s, then it is quite straightforward to find the denominator polynomial by simply multiplying out s minus the roots. You know the roots, you can find the polynomial to within a scaling factor, right? And you assume the DC gain is 1, so scaling factor is also known, and that was the so called Butterworth filter approximation, also called the maximally flat approximation. Now let us attempt another approximation. This is the ideal low pass filter characteristic 1 1, okay, and our approximation will be, for example, something like this, okay, where the filter response is not exactly flat but is rippling around in the pass band, right, and the value of the cusps is denoted as by this strange looking quantity 1 by 1 plus epsilon square under root. In a couple of minutes, I will give you an explanation why I chose this rather strange sounding quantity. But for the time being, one must understand that as epsilon tends to 0, the amount of ripple in the pass band will reduce or increase? Will reduce, correct? So, epsilon controls the pass band ripple, and for a given degree of ripple, therefore, one can go and back calculate epsilon, okay. Can anybody comment on the nature of the approximation? No, that's okay. But I mean, when can you look at something straight away and see? Can you say, hey, I can do a better job of reducing the error between the desired and the actual? Yeah. So another somewhat strange thing is that the desired characteristic is always larger than the approximation. Okay. Again, this is because of both this as well as this strange looking 1 by square root of 1 plus epsilon square is turns out to be just for mathematical convenience. In, you know, you can actually think of the red curve or the red response approximating the ideal brick wall which is drawn, this is in blue, right, in which case the error seems to be both positive and negative and half the magnitude. Okay, so it just turns out that it's simpler to deal with this way, and as I've just shown you, both of them are equivalent, right? It's just like, instead of saying I will approximate the ideal brick wall which is 1 and 0, I will now try and approximate a brick wall which is 1 plus 1 by square root of 1 plus epsilon square by 2, okay, and 0, correct? Okay, now if this, if you would like to realize a characteristic like the one shown in red, and we want to do it again with only a filter which has all zeros at infinity, which means you want an all pole approximation, then again mod h of j omega square must be of the form 1 by d of omega square, because the magnitude response must be an even function of frequency, just like in the Butterworth case. So just in the same manner as we proceeded in the Butterworth example, we said it is easier to deal with polynomials than reciprocals of polynomials. So if 1 by d omega square does something like this with ripple, then what do you think d of omega square will do? So what is the ideal step doing? The ideal step is doing 1 and infinity. Okay. What is 1 by d of omega square doing where? It starts from 1, correct? Okay. So again, please note that we are, that the diagram I have drawn there is mod h of j omega, right? We are now interested in mod h of j omega whole square, which means what must 1 by d of omega square be doing, or rather what must d of omega square be doing? Yeah, it must go, it must start off at 1 and then keep rippling this way. Okay. Alright. And again, omega equal to 1 denotes the so-called passband edge, right? And this fellow must therefore be 1 plus epsilon square. Correct? All right. Now, the next step, therefore, you know, just as we did yesterday, is what? Yes. No, why will it square? Why will it change? You are just squaring the magnitude, no? So, the depth of the ripple will change, but not the frequency. It's kind of awkward to deal with 1 plus something, right? So it simply makes sense to deal with, this is 1 and infinity. Instead of that, you say you want to try to approximate 0 and infinity. In other words, you do something like, what you're trying to approximate is something like this. Alright. And what will this be now? Epsilon square. Very good. Okay. Now, you can say, therefore, that the approximation we have is 1 by 1 plus f of omega square, where this is f of omega square. And you know, if you want further mathematical nicety, you would say, you get rid of the epsilon also and say, this goes to 1 and you say, you denote this as 1 by 1 plus epsilon square F1 of omega square. Okay. So, this becomes F1 of omega square. Please note that we are basically sitting on 120 years of math, okay. This way of equiripple approximation came about in the design of steam engines apparently in the early 1890s. There is a lot of theory on why this is a good way of doing things, right. And given that this is so mathematically mature, you know, all these notation and all that, people must have first started doing 1 and 1 minus delta in the pass band, found that, you know, the kind of stuff that you get here becomes very messy and gone backwards. You know, when you know the answer, after that you can always reconstruct the whole thing very nicely, okay. But when you are first starting out, it will seem a little strange. Hey, why, how did this guy know this square root of, how did he know that if it is 1 by 1 plus square root of epsilon square, it all comes out nicely. The reason is that he has done it before and then he knows that if he does this, then you will get something clean later, okay. Yes. That's how you define the pass band edge. The pass band edge is defined as the frequency at which the rippling just stops and for example, this is defined as the pass band edge where the frequency response dips, goes up and dips for the last time and intersects this 1 by square root of 1 plus epsilon square, okay. Now, the job therefore is for us, so what are we after now? What should we do? We need to find, no, the ratio of polynomials, all that is over. Now, what, we have gone much beyond that. All that we need to do is now find an F1 of omega square which behaves like this. If F1 of omega square behaves like this, in other words, if you find an even polynomial of order, say, some 2n, right, which behaves like this, then if you form 1 by 1 plus epsilon square F1 of omega square, then H1 of mod H1 of j omega whole square will behave like that equiripple approximation. Is this clear? Okay. Now, again, as I said, we are sitting on a century of math and this whole theory has been is actually apparently quite mathematically complicated. So, we will not be able to go into the details of all that, but I will try and give you some intuition as to how on earth one can take a look at this desired behavior and get at an expression for the polynomial which gives this kind of behavior, okay. So, F1 of omega square obviously is an even function. Correct? And we seem to know it's zeros. Let's call, I mean, what are the critical points here which deserve mention? One is this guy, which I will, let me just make a blow up of this so that this is 1, this is F1 of omega square, 0, the critical points are omega 1, I will denote them by omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, omega 4 and of course 1. And we do know that what we want is that the peaks all line up to 1, correct? Now the question we would like to ask is, how would we, what is f1 of omega square? Yes. Yeah, I'll come to that. Okay. All right. Now, f1 of omega square is an even function of frequency, and let's see what intuition we can get. Clearly, f1 of omega square is 0 at 0, correct? And it's an even function. So, if you have an even function which is 0 at 0, what can you say? How will the function be at around the origin? You will have only
omega.
If you have an even function of omega and its value at 0 happens to be 0, then at small frequencies, how can you represent? It will be, you can say it is omega square, correct? So, f1 of omega square must be proportional to omega square. Alright. Now, any other thing that you notice? Please notice this part. Okay. So, there the curve is doing this. In a narrow neighborhood of omega 2, how does it look like? Very good. It looks like a parabola. Alright. So, this must be, you must also have a factor of omega minus omega 2 the whole square. But please recall that this is an even function. So, if I make a mirror image, this cusp will also occur at minus omega 2, correct? Which means that around minus omega 2, it must look like a parabola. And what might be the equation of that parabola? Omega plus omega 2 the whole square, which means that if I now multiply omega minus omega 2 and omega plus omega 2, what will I get? Omega square minus omega 2 whole square, the whole square. Right? Okay. Now, by extension, what else? What are the omega square minus 4 square, the whole square. Correct? Okay. And is there anything else I have missed out?
You have to make sure that the value of the omega.
That's later, but I mean, these are all, is this now an equality or a proportionality? It's a proportionality to within a constant. Let me call that constant k square, simply because everything here seems to be a square. Right? Okay. And as omega tends to infinity, we see that this must be positive. So, I choose a positive constant, which can also be written as k square. So, this is the lowest degree polynomial which can give me this kind of behavior. You understand? There is nothing prevents me from taking this and omega to the power 4 times omega square minus omega 2 square whole to the power 4 times omega square minus omega 4 square whole to the power 4 will also give me a similar behavior qualitatively. Right? But this is the lowest degree polynomial which can give me this kind of behavior. Is that clear? If I do omega square minus omega 2 square whole to the power 4, it will become even flatter at omega 2. Do you understand? But the lowest degree polynomial which can give me this kind of behavior is this. Okay? So, in other words, then what is the degree of this polynomial? Please. So, f1 of omega square has a degree equal to 10, which is also the degree of the denominator polynomial, the whole square, which means what is the order of the filter? It's a fifth order filter. Okay, I've just taken a numerical example just to, you know, without doing n at this point. So, this corresponds to a fifth order D of S. Is this clear? All right. Now, so F1 of omega square is therefore k square times omega square times omega square minus omega 2 square, the whole square, times omega square minus omega 4 square, the whole square. All right. So, at this point, we have still not exploited one fact. Okay. That is, well, or you know, the peaks line up, correct? Please note that I can, if I mean, there must be some intelligent choice of omega 2 and omega 4 which will make the ripple, which will make the peaks the same. If I randomly choose omega 2 and omega 4, it is not likely that the peaks line up. Does this make sense? Okay. If I choose any random omega 2 and omega 4, all right, I will still get a cusp here and a cusp here. But any random choice will not make the peaks the same. So, omega 2 and omega 4 had to be chosen in a smart slash special way in order to make the peaks the same. Correct? I mean, for example, if I now move, let's say I have somehow found the optimal positions omega 2 and omega 4. If I move omega 2 to the right, what do you think will happen? Look at the picture and tell me. Of course, omega 1 will also shift slightly. But if I move omega 2 to the right, then you can expect the first peak to increase and the second peak to decrease, thereby increasing the maximum error that is there between the approximation and the desire. You understand? Please note at this point, the error between what you desire, which is 0, and the peak that you have is 1. Correct? For the optimal values of omega 2 and omega 4. If omega 2 was perturbed by a little bit, the peak error will increase. Does it make sense? Okay. Now, coming back to this. The peaks are the same, which means that if I take this curve and subtract 1 from it, then what will happen? F1 of omega square minus 1 will look like just easier to copy and paste. So, F1 of omega square minus 1 should look like this if the peaks are indeed the same. Correct? Now, therefore, F1 of omega square minus 1 can be expressed as what? What happens around omega 1? Same logic as before. So, F1 of omega square minus 1 can therefore be written as omega minus omega square minus omega 1 square, the whole square. Correct? Because the minus of the plus and the minus of the negative side will cancel out, will become a plus 1. Similarly, multiplied by, come on people, omega square minus omega 3 square, the whole square. What else? And please note that there's also a simple zero at omega equal to 1. So, omega minus 1 must be a factor of F1 of omega square minus 1. Correct? Yes? So, if plus 1 is a factor, is a root, minus 1 is also a root by even symmetry. Therefore, this must be omega square minus 1. Now, is this an equality or a proportionality? Okay, this is a proportionality. What is the constant you think? What is the constant? So, every term in F1 of omega square is a square. Therefore, F1 of omega square is a perfect square. Correct? And as we just discussed, the behavior at high frequencies of omega f1 of omega square and f1 of omega square minus 1 is the same, which therefore means that this constant of proportionality here must also be k square. Now, since f1 of omega square is a perfect square, this can be written as k times omega times omega square minus omega 2 square times omega square minus omega 4 square, the whole square, okay, where of course this stuff in brackets is a fifth order polynomial, which keep you anticipating future results. I will call this C5 of omega. Okay, and let's see how C5 of omega looks when I plot it. So, how will this look like? At omega 1, there must be a maxima. At omega 2, it must be? This must be C5 of omega the whole square. Okay. So, at omega 1, it must be 1. At omega 2, it must be 0. At omega 3, it must be? Minus 1. At omega 4 must be 0. At omega 5 equal to 1, at 1 must be 1. I'm sorry, my drawing skills are not. Only marginally better. Okay, this is the best I can do. Does it make sense? Okay, this is 1 and this is minus 1. Now, what do you notice? Where are the maxima of this curve, maxima slash minima occurring? So, therefore, so, even though the slopes are 0 in f1 of omega square at omega 1, omega 2 and omega 3 and omega 4, right, there is a quantitative difference between omega 1, omega 3 and there is a qualitative difference between omega 1, omega 3 and omega 2, omega 4. What is the difference? Omega 1 and omega 3 are frequencies where the curve goes to its maxima, whereas omega 2 and omega 4 are frequencies of minima, and that comes out when you just take the square root, that's immediately apparent. Okay, so you see that once you take the square root of this, we notice that at omega 1 and omega 3 there are maxima slash minima, whereas the minima at omega 2 and omega 4 go away, correct? So, it therefore means that dc5, so there are maxima at omega 1 and maxima slash omega minima at omega 1 and omega 3. Therefore, if I differentiate dc5 with respect to omega, right, it must go to 0 at what frequencies? Omega 1, omega 3 and by symmetry? Minus omega 1 and minus omega 3. So, dc5 by d omega can be written as quick omega square minus omega 1 square times omega square minus omega 3 square. Alright. And is this equality or constant of, I mean, proportionality? Proportionality. So, how will I find the constant? C5 for large frequencies is must be k into omega to the power 5, correct? Which means that dc5 by d omega must go as 5k omega to the power 4 for large frequency. So, now what is the constant of proportionality? dc5 by d omega must therefore be, yes people, 5k. Very good. Alright. And let me just remind you of an earlier equation we derived. Okay, this is what we had derived earlier for f1 of omega square minus 1. And what is f1 of omega square? By definition, it is c5 square minus 1. F1 of omega square, we denoted as c5 square, bearing in mind that it is a perfect square. So, these are, you know, whatever information we got, we had looking at the curve, we seem to have exploited. What are all the, what is the information? It goes to 0 at omega 2 and omega 4, right? Then, but it goes to maxima at omega 1 and omega 3, right? So, that by itself is not enough. If I randomly choose omega 2 and omega 4, it will still go to peaks somewhere in the middle. But I have also exploited the fact that the peaks are equal, which is equivalent to saying C5 square minus 1 must go to 0 at omega 1 square and omega 3 square and at 1. Is this clear? Okay. Now, can somebody take a look at this and see how we can eliminate omega 1 and omega 3? I mean, they are the unknowns. So, 1 by 5 dc5 by d omega whole square therefore must be c5 square minus 1. And please note, I mean all that I am doing is noticing that this part and this part is, one is the square of the other. Okay. So, if I do 1 over 5 times dc5 by d omega the whole square, that must be equal to c5 square minus 1 by omega square minus 1. Okay. Alright. What is, you know, what is the trick? The trick is, we didn't know omega 1 and omega 3, correct? And by looking at those curves and noticing that omega 1 and omega 3 are true, what do you call, maxima. Okay. This is a clever trick to get rid of the unknowns and therefore come up with a differential equation. So, dc5 by square root of c5 square minus 1 must be d omega by times 5 by square root of omega square minus 1. Does it make sense? Okay, and for those of you who have forgotten your tables of integrals, this you can integrate both sides. This happens to be somebody? Okay, it turns out to be cos hyperbolic inverse of C5 of omega. Okay, all right, and this must be 5, therefore this must be cos hyperbolic inverse of omega plus some constant of proportionality. Let me call that okay, so for those of you who don't tend to believe me, let me if this is correct, then when I differentiate, for example, if this is right, then if I differentiate cos hyperbolic inverse omega, I must get 1 by square root of omega square minus 1. So let's say y is cos hyperbolic inverse omega, and I want to find, so which means that cos hyperbolic y is omega, which means sin hyperbolic y dy by d omega must be 1. And what is sin hyperbolic y in terms of cos hyperbolic y? So this must be 1 by omega square. Right. Please note that cos hyperbolic square minus sin hyperbolic square is 1. Okay, and what is cos, now I am getting doubts. What is cos hyperbolic? I start hearing I somewhere. Why is I coming? Cos hyperbolic is e to the power x plus e to the power minus x by 2. Okay, what is the minimum value of cos hyperbolic x? 1. Okay, when the argument is real. Sin hyperbolic x is what? E to the x minus e to the minus x by 2. Okay, what is sin x? E to the jx minus e to the, so you can see that the formula are very similar. So there must be a relationship between cos hyperbolic and cos, and similarly sin hyperbolic and sin. Okay, anyways, using this hyperbolic cos or cos hyperbolic, not cos, to cos somebody is to beat somebody, you understand? Okay, all right. So it turns out that, so I hope all of you are now convinced about the integral. So if this is right, then cos 5 of C5 of omega is therefore cos hyperbolic 5 cos inverse hyperbolic omega plus some constant. And what is the constant? At omega equal to 0, C5 of omega must be 0, 0, 1, yeah, 0, oh sorry, at omega equal to 1, let me see one second, at omega equal to 1, the reason why you can't use omega equal to 0, I'll come back, okay. Why can't I use omega equal to 0? Cos hyperbolic inverse of 0 is not a real number, right? So at omega equal to 1, C5 of omega must be 1, and at omega equal to 1, therefore, so C5 of 1 must be equal to 1, which is cos hyperbolic of 5 cos hyperbolic inverse of 1. What is cos hyperbolic inverse of 1? 0. So 0 plus constant. So what must the constant be? 0. So C5 of omega is therefore cos hyperbolic of 5 cos hyperbolic inverse of omega in general. What do you think Cn of omega will be? No prizes for guessing this. Cos hyperbolic of n cos hyperbolic inverse of omega. I'll come to that. Right? Obviously, there are several gochas here. One, what were we expecting? So, this is nothing but, so this Cn square is supposed to be what kind of function? C1 of omega square, Cn of omega the whole square is a polynomial, right? But this doesn't look anything like a polynomial. I mean, generally if I see sine of cos of, then I mean, a fat chance that it is a polynomial, right? But quite amazingly, it does indeed turn out to be a polynomial, right? So I'll show you another form which yes.
Wait, took the square root before calculating, integrating. You only took the positive integral.
Yeah, I mean, I could have taken the negative square root, and then you would get minus of.
No, but it depends on which range of omega it is.
It is a. I mean, finally, if it's a polynomial, you can't suddenly have a kink, isn't it? So you either have something which goes like this, or something which is minus 1 times what we assume. That's all. You can't have a positive square root here and negative square root there. Then there will be a kink at 0, at wherever it crosses 0. Right? That can't happen because we are dealing with polynomials. Okay? Alright. There are two questions that an inquisitive mind will ask now. One, is this a polynomial? And two, what about zero less than omega less than one? Why does the second question make sense? Cos hyperbolic inverse doesn't exist for, I mean, at least you can't have. What do you call cos hyperbolic for real arguments? Only the smallest it will be is 1, which means that cos hyperbolic inverse of some number smaller than 1 cannot have a real solution. You understand? So it turns out, as I will show you quickly. Yeah, that's what I want to point out, right? So cos theta, just for those of you who have forgotten your, cos theta is e to the j theta plus e to the minus j theta by 2. Cos of j theta is what? E to the minus theta plus e to the theta by 2, which is cos hyperbolic of theta. So if the argument of the cosine becomes imaginary, then you can have, in other words, cosine can become greater than 1, right? Only the argument is real, cosine lies between plus and minus 1. If the argument becomes imaginary, then the value of the cosine is always greater than 1 because it's cos hyperbolic of something which is real, which is always greater than 1. Turning the whole thing upside down, cos hyperbolic inverse of what is this? Of theta is, you know, I mean, if theta is greater than 1, there is no problem. If theta is less than 1, what does it mean? So this must be j cos inverse. Correct? This is nothing but, it's just this rewritten. Alright? Okay, we'll continue in the next class.